Good morning. God bless you. Welcome to the sanctuary. It's so good to see all of you here this morning. A lot of exciting things in store for you in this next hour, so we're so happy that you're here. Brothers and sisters, good to see you, and welcome to all of our visitors that are here this morning. We also want to remember that a lot of our church family and a lot of people still are listening to us by way of radio or watching us later in this afternoon on Facebook Live or YouTube. So we want to say welcome to them as well. Just a couple quick announcements, and then I'm going to move out of the way because once it starts, it's going to roll, right, Chris? Just want to remind you that if you have a prayer concern this morning, if you would pay particular attention to the Gmail address on the screen, those concerns need to be relayed to Patty and to Jane, and they will share those with the prayer team, and we want to assure you that your concerns will be lifted up and will be prayed over. As Chris always reminds us, there's one thing that we do really well here at the church, and that is the prayer ministry. So any concerns that you have on your heart, any praises that you would like to share, they would love to share those with you. If you have something confidential on your heart, just let them know, and they will make sure to respect your wishes there. Continue to thank our church family for your support of the ministry and the missions of the church. Lots of different ways that you can continue to support the church. And because of COVID, we're doing things, had to do things a little bit different. So I'm not going to go over all of those things, but you'll see those ways on the screen that you can continue to be faithful in your tithes and your offering. So God bless you for that. We surely do appreciate that. Donna has a quick announcement she would like to make with you.
Okay, I'm here this morning to announce that we have a church member who wants to do a July blast. What that is they have made a donation of $1,000 for our building fund to pay off this church building. We are asking that other people step up and make a pledge to that challenge. It doesn't have to be $1,000, it can be whatever. But we would like to do this within the next couple Sundays, so this will be an exciting end of July that we could possibly get this building paid off. And we appreciate all your help going forward and in the past. And I just have to say that I was in early service, and wow, you all are in for a treat today. I just have to say.
Thank you, Donna. I think those are all the announcements. Again, welcome this morning. God is good.
All the time.
God is good. Andrea, will you lead us in our music this morning?
And his mercies are new every morning. So as we celebrate his new mercies today, let us stand and sing, "Great is thy faithfulness."
Standing this morning, and let's recite the Apostles' Creed together. This is the traditional version. Would you join me? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Turn and greet your neighbor this morning. Extend a handshake, a word of welcome, a hug, and then you may be seated.
Don't you want to be the closest?
John 4:11-12. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us.
Great prayer for us this morning. Just make us channels of your peace, Lord. This is our time where we pray together. As Jerry said, that email is one of the best ways to get your prayer request in. Or as always, you can just grab a hold of me or Pastor Willard. You can text or email or call or whatever, so that we're able to pass that on to that prayer team. I've said this before, but I keep going back to it because I'm just struck by it. I was able to spend a couple of weeks in England and got to visit John Wesley's house one time. And he's the founder of the Methodist Church. And they say that his prayer closet is the powerhouse of the Methodist Church, that it wouldn't even exist if it wasn't for that prayer closet. And so, and he he has this prayer bench, and right where the feet would be, it's worn. The whole floor is just kind of grooved down, and they said he would pray 7, 8, 9, 10 times a day. And so there's nothing that's more powerful than prayer. So if you have a request, we would love to pray with you and for you. And I will lead us in a prayer, and then we will end by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Pray with me if you will. Father God, we are thankful to be able to gather here in this place. We give you thanks and praise, first and foremost, to your Son, Jesus Christ, because without him, we are nothing. Father, I give you thanks for the opportunity to gather and to worship with no worries, no fears. We know that there's situations and places on this planet, Father, where people can't worship you openly, and so we give you thanks that we are able to do that this morning. Father, I lift up requests that have been sent in or spoken to us. We lift them up to you this morning. Father, we lift up the requests that we don't talk about, those silent requests that seem to just keep us awake day and night. Father, I pray for our church. I pray for our community. I pray for the leadership of this place and of our country and even of the world, Father, that continually that we are drawn to you in every situation, in every circumstance. I pray that this service be just a path that points people to your goodness, your glory, and your victory. I pray that we experience the renewing of our hearts and our minds, and most importantly, our soul and our spirit. Father, I pray these things in your name. And we pray together the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Colossians 3:23-24. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving.
Good morning. Good morning. My name is Rachel, for those of you who don't know me, and I want to tell you a little about the mission trip we got to go on this summer. Think big. These words might not mean that much to you all, but they do to us, and here's why. So you arrive to the team effort work site with no idea of the task you'll be doing. You often think of a mission trip as going to build something. However, with this trip, we were just a small piece of a much bigger picture. Now, you might wonder what I mean when I say part of a bigger picture. Well, let me explain this with a story that you're all familiar with, the birth of Jesus. See, God chose the Virgin Mary to give birth to his son, who would be the savior of the world. Why, you ask? Because she was the star of his bigger picture. And then Mary was sent into a stable, a place where animals sleep, to give birth to her baby, with nothing but a manger to lay him in. These are unwanted circumstances to any parent, but these things happened because they're part of God's bigger picture. She was just the star of his big plan. Going into the trip, we had to do a lot of cleanup for the groups to come after us. One of the people we worked for, Beverly, hadn't had water in 16 months, something we often take for granted. And because of the work that we did in her yard, it was ready for a well to be put in so she could have water. Brian, another person we got to work for, had holes in his house big enough to walk through. And because of the work that we did, the next group was able to give him sliding. But even more than how we got to fit into God's bigger picture, we were able to build relationships with Brian, who had never allowed team effort to do work for him until now, and Beverly, who had gone months without water. Sometimes it's not all about doing work so that you can receive all of the credit and recognition. but it's about planting a seed and trusting that God has a bigger plan, just like Mary did. And I know that because I've seen it. And I've seen it in my fellow students and youth. And I've seen it in Chris and Billy. And I've got to see Lucas go from the little kid running around at Kaylin's house to getting baptized and giving his life to the Lord. So I know he has a bigger plan. And I want to leave you with this verse. Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. Proverbs 19:21. I'm so thankful I got to experience this week of missions, and I'm so thankful that I've got to grow up in a group of such amazing kids. And I know that no matter where I go, I'll always have Chris and Billy in my corner. Thank you.
My name's Hannah, and I'm going to be talking about act small. Ephesians 1:11 says, "Furthermore, because we are united with Christ, we have received an inheritance from God. For he chose us in advance, and he makes everything work out according to his plan." The biggest thing that stood out to me on the mission trip to Jacksonville, Florida, was definitely the teamwork. Our group is so, so special, and that when we are together, we become selfless. Nothing is to glorify us, it is to glorify God and his plan. We were only a tiny part of what God has planned, and this can be seen in what we did on the trip. On the mission trip, our group ultimately cleared a forest and tore down vines that had overgrown and was covering a house. Each one of us, although only doing something small like moving a few sticks or picking up a piece of trash and taking it to a garbage can, accomplished something huge. Miss Beverly, like Rachel said, had not had running water in over 15 months, and so we got the opportunity to clear out her yard so that a well could be built for her by the group the following week. We also removed the vines from Brian's house and made it safe for his son to run and play when he came and visited him. And while doing all of this, we, most importantly, had the opportunity to make them feel loved. Team effort is all about act small. All the small things that we do one week become part of their huge plan for these homeowners. Even though this trip was nothing like we had planned going into it, tearing down the forest is what God needed us to do that week, and I'm sure everyone who was on the trip, including myself, would tell you how much we enjoyed being able to do the work for these homeowners, and most importantly, God. Our doings may be small, but they are all just part of God's master plan.
Morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Kyle Bowe. I failed to introduce myself this morning at the first service, I guess. Public speaking is not my thing. But for those of you who don't know or remember me, you may think Tom or Barbie when I say my name, or you may think, man, I watched that kid grow up playing on the ball field all those years ago. And yeah, that was I'm that same kid. And I didn't really grow up anymore, but I did move away, and I grew out. It's a strange thing. It's not funny. And one of the reasons that's happened is I met a family. I met my family. And my family's a little bit different. They're a little bit unique in that when I met my wife, she was a widow, lost her husband in a motor vehicle accident, and she at that time had a 9 and a 7-year-old, and those are my kids now. And Jackson is the one we're going to really talk about today. He went on the mission trip. I did not. Jackson is now 13, and I met him about 2 years ago. And you know, people said, "Oh man, marriage is tough," you know, and I'm going, okay, well, you know what? Marriage is not tough in my world. I have an amazing wife, and she has a lot of grace, which goes a long way when you're married to a guy like me. And but parenting, that was a new thing for me. And I might be a pediatrician, and I might deal with kids every single day. But I got to be honest, this was something I wasn't prepared for. And so my daughter, she might have been a little closer to her mom than her dad, and she was a little younger as well. And developing a relationship with her, that wasn't a struggle for me. It was actually really easy. The first morning I met her, she threw her arms around me, and I was melted then and there, and it's been wonderful ever since. But Jackson, my 13-year-old, he was a little more difficult. You know, he was really close with his dad. That was his hero, the guy he spent all his time with. And he was plenty old enough. He was 11, so he knew, or sorry, he was 9, so he knew everything going on. And because of this situation, me and him have had a really, really hard time developing a relationship. You know, I've tried to put myself in his shoes, which I can't. I tried to understand what he was feeling, what he was going through, but all the things that I thought about and all the things that I tried, I just couldn't put it together. And I'm not telling you whether he's stubborn or I'm stubborn. Don't ask my wife. But, I mean, it almost became uncomfortable to be around us because we really butt heads a lot. And it just wasn't what I had imagined being a father would be like. And I didn't have an answer. And, you know, being a doctor, that's what we try to do. We try to fix everything and everybody. But I couldn't. I couldn't do this. And so so Jackson goes on this mission trip. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't expect anything. He's been on other trips before. He's been at other church camps. He's just done things. And I didn't expect things to change. But what I can tell you from this mission trip, when he left, when he got back, is there's been a complete transformation in our relationship, in our ability to get along with one another. He's part of, it's just brought the family together. We don't argue, we don't fight. He is cool with the idea that he can have a relationship with me. And I don't know if he felt guilty about having a relationship with me. I don't know. I don't know what it was. I don't have that answer, but I don't know if it's Chris and Billy and conversations they had. I don't know if it came from the conversations he might have had with other kids or the conversations of the people they were serving, but there was a change. God moved one way or the other. God orchestrated this, and he moved, and it has transformed our family. In the last 3 weeks, have been a real just breath, a spiritual breath of fresh air that has really helped us move forward. And I cannot thank Chris and Billy and the church enough for sending these kids on trips like this, because these are the things that happen. And you may not think this was the way this was going to go, but it was. This was something that made that difference. And I'm just very thankful for you guys. I'm thankful for the church. I'm thankful for Chris and Billy, what happened. So, you know, this thing, I didn't realize earlier, one was think big, one was act small. I was actually pretty hard. I didn't know it, and I do all the time. I just didn't know this is what I was praying for. So thank you guys for being part of that. Thank you.
Good morning. I'd like to thank you all for your donations and your prayers for the 2021 mission trip in Jacksonville. Today, we are showing you how your donations and many prayers impacted all that were involved. Jacksonville was my first mission trip, and to be honest, I really didn't know what to expect, but I knew it was probably going to be awesome, and it sure was. One pair of words on our t-shirts for this year was "love well." When I first saw these shirts, I thought to love well means being patient, not to envy, not to boast, not to be proud. Jesus said that it's important. I figured it meant to love everyone as Christ commands and to love everyone in our group and the other groups there. But in Jacksonville, love well meant so much more. The friendships we made in Jacksonville were last a lifetime. We grew as a group, and one thing about this trip is that there was so much laughter. All throughout the trip, all everyone did was laugh. Work, yes, but we enjoyed doing it. I can think of only one time out of the whole week when no one was laughing. That's when we caught our first glimpse of the shepherd's pie they had. And after we tasted it, all of us founded really fast. As the week progressed, we started including the other youth groups in our games and worshiped with them at chapel. We actually came to know them pretty well. You know, that's just one of the things that makes this youth group so special. We love and include people outside the group and make them feel welcomed. We actually adopted a kid from Wyoming named Kirk. He was friendly and kind when we first met him, and as the week progressed, we were like, wow, he's one of us. He still talks to us on social media and stuff. The two people that Team Effort was helping were Miss Beverly and Mr. Brian. We worked hard and we worked well. I worked at Brian's house. When Brian first saw us, he was kind of timid and in disbelief. But as the days went on, he quickly warmed up to us and we to him. He said countless times, "You all are such a blessing. I can't believe this. Thank you all so much." Beverly accepted us just as well. It was such a blessing to work for them. Monday, Beverly and Brian were strangers to us. But by the end of the week, we were the best of friends. The Team Effort staff and their campus was also wonderful. No complaints from this kid. Every night was fun and fruitful. But the last night, when they summed everything up, that was special. God truly moved. People prayed for each other, and some people received Christ. It was such a, well, indescribable moment. The final words of that last chapel service was written on a big board, and it said, "Still, I will trust." And that was very powerful, and it spoke to me. I came to the realization that trusting God isn't trusting him to help us in our plan. Trusting God is trusting him to mold us into his plan. And so after I saw the love that we as a group had for each other and the other groups there, after I saw the love that we showed Beverly and Brian, and after I saw how well the Team Effort staff loved us, then I understood what love well truly means. God is love. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. God commends his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God loves. So when the back of the shirt says love well, replace it with God will. Be Christ-like will, and be the salt of the earth as Jesus instructs us to be. After this trip, I learned that sharing the love of Christ isn't just telling people about him or preaching a good sermon. It's what our actions do, the impacts that we make when we treat others with that same love that Christ had. In Luke, the Bible says that a blind man came to Jesus and said, "Lord, I want to see." That was my prayer coming in, that I may see God move on this trip in a way that I'd never seen him before. And he answered that prayer. And there's a saying that goes, "I'd rather see a sermon than hear one any day." God made that saying true, and he lit a fire in each of our hearts that will never extinguish as long as we trust God and love well. In Jacksonville, God taught us how to love well, grow in Christ, and to hopefully serve better in Jesus' name. But that Thursday night, at the last night of chapel, I knew an invitation would be given, and I prayed to God, and I said, "Lord, if there be someone who's struggling right tonight, I pray that you may come into their heart, that they may accept you as their Lord and Savior." And lo and behold, I prayed that prayer, and my brother Jackson came to receive Christ, along with a couple other people in our group. So that's just how God is good. My brother Jackson has gone to church his whole life, but on this mission trip he saw that it's not good enough just to go to church. So when the invitation was given that Thursday night at chapel, he, along with others, came to the cross for repentance to make Jesus the Lord and Master of his life. The next day, he couldn't wait to be baptized, and he was in the ocean. That's pretty cool. That was the best blessing for the whole trip for me, and I could have never have guessed it. I couldn't imagine that he'd be baptized in the ocean. I wasn't. Praise God for answering prayers and coming into my brother's heart. And also praise God for forever changing the hearts of our whole group this trip. And finally praise God that we're going to have two baptisms today. Bryce and Lucas are going to give their lives to the Lord today, so it's a wonderful day. Thank you.
So we're going to watch a short video. And it's going to kind of recap our week away in Jacksonville. You're going to see people on here you're not going to know. I mean, there's going to be a bus driver jumping rope. And he does that because these kids have transformed his heart. You're going to get to see and experience just a glimpse of what these people have talked about. Let's take a look.
Thank you.
pulled into our first day of work, and the bus driver says, "What happened?" I said, "Well, you can let us out, but we have to be at somewhere at noon. It's about 8 or 10 miles away, and so you need to come and get us and take us for lunch to this little park." He said, "Well, do I wait here? Do I leave?" I said, "Well, that's up to you." He looked at me and said, "Can I help?" And that began something special. Well, it already started, but I mean, and so he gets off and you see him carrying the thing and he chainsaw, he did everything. And I mean, he jumped rope. He had, and so on our way back, they had to switch drivers because of the time log. And as he got off, he took the microphone for the bus and he gave a speech. And as he was talking, he just was in tears and he walked all the way to the back. And I think he hugged every person as he got off the bus. He said, "This is my first mission trip I've ever been on." He said, "I will never forget you guys."
You know, one of my favorite things about the trip is we took kids from 10 different Sunday morning churches. Okay, 10 different Sunday morning churches. And it didn't matter. No denominational boundaries keeping us from working together, nothing. And they worked hard. I don't know if you noticed, but it rained a little.
Every day.
And you know, at the end of the week, the team effort staff said, had it not rained, we would have run out of work for them to do. They literally moved a forest in about 2 days. And they worked hard and they worked together. And you know, I said this in early service, and I'm going to say it again. People say all the time, "Yeah, children are the church of tomorrow. They're the church of today." Today. And these kids make such a difference in our life. They just need purpose and to be driven. I can't. There's not enough words for me to say how I feel about them and how they've impacted our life.
So you heard about Miss Beverly didn't have water. 16 months. I mean, and one of the girls that was with us said, "I can't even imagine that. We're going to a park and there's spigots just everywhere. How can somebody in America today not have water?" And so these kids made a way to where the Monday after we left, there was a drilling rig got to come in. It couldn't even get into the property. And so they were able to come in and set up and drill her a well, and now she has running water. Now think about water. You know, Moses and Noah were saved by water. Think about John the Baptist baptized Jesus in water. Think about Jesus' first miracle, water to wine. On the cross, they stuck a spear in Jesus' side and water come out. Revelation tells us that there's a stream of water that flows from the throne. All through Jesus' ministry, he says, "I'm the living water." And so I think about how important and how essential water is, not to just to be alive, but for us to live. And this morning we get to see what water can do in turning a grave into a garden. We get to see in this rebirth through water. Kids will never forget this trip. And there's families that'll never be the same because of things that happen in ministries. And I want you to know that Jesus Christ is alive and working today. He's not just working in this group that went, but he's working in your life and he's working in our schools, whether they want to, no matter what, where they work, he's working in the Congress, he's working through presidents, he's working through world leaders. Jesus Christ is alive and working today. And we get to see some of that evidence right now.
I want to add something. Those of you who know us know we work really closely with Dare to Share in Denver, Colorado. About 10 days ago, somebody from there posted something that really convicted me as a Christian. He posted, "How dare you as a believer live your life as if God hasn't been good to you?" And it really has convicted me because there's days I live my life like God hasn't been good to me. On this trip, these kids live their life like God had been good to them. You know, Miss Beverly was on a walker. That's how she got water. She walked across the road with a tidy bowl box to get water. And we pour it out when it gets too warm in the bottle. How dare we live like God hasn't been good to us? It's time, church. The world needs us.
So I'm going to ask Lucas to come on up.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation. And we are given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. Lucas, on behalf of the church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, will you say, I do?
I do.
And do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, will you say, I do?
I do.
And do you confess your Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, will you say, I do?
I do.
And will you, church, nurture Lucas in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he could be guided as he accepts God's grace for himself and can openly profess his faith and lead a Christian life? If so, will you say, we will?
We will.
And will all of us, by the grace given to us, remain as faithful members of Christ's universal church and serve as Christ's church in this world? If so, will you say, we will?
We will.
You know, when you get to your favorite song, sometimes you just like to hear it again. We're going to hear this one again.
Second verse,
same as the first. We will ask Bryce the questions. And Bryce is going to be baptized by Chris and his grandfather. Yeah, no phone, right? All right. You know, there's some phones that probably ought to be baptized. Bryce, on behalf of the church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, will you say, I do?
I do.
And do you accept the freedom and power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression, whatever forms they present themselves? If so, will you say, I do? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, will you say, I do? And will you, my brothers and sisters, nurture Bryce in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept and profess the grace of God for himself as he lives his life of faith openly as a Christian life? With so will you say, we will. And will you, according to the grace given to you, remain as faithful members of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's church in this world? If so, will you say, we will?
We will.
We rejoice and give thanks at what God is doing in their lives. We celebrate together this day. I'm going to ask Chris to come lead us in the next part.
We're missing an Abby. Oh, there she is. We don't have to stop here. We're getting ready to sing a song called From Graves to Gardens. And I was at a concert one time. David Crowder was speaking. He said Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. He came to take dead people, make them come alive. So if you're feeling dead, if you feel like you're in a corner, if you feel like life has just beat you up and you need something new and you've tried everything, let me tell you, Jesus is the way. We've got the tank ready. If something moves in you, maybe you need to move in it. Know that that invitation is open. It's open here this morning.
Will you guys please stand and sing with me?
There's nothing
see Lucas. Where's Bryce? Is he back? It might take a minute. We're going to give him a minute, Chris.
Go ahead and be seated.
There it goes.
Didn't have his walk-up music ready. So this has been an amazing day. And if God has stirred something in your heart, know that we're always available.
Yes.
And we would love nothing more than to help point you to Jesus.
The early service, I said, this is the journey for which I signed up. The paperwork and the headache and the meetings and all the things that go with it sometimes are a struggle. And sometimes it's easy to forget why you do what you do. And then you have a morning like we have today and you go, oh, that's why we do this. I'm going to invite Lucas and Bryce to stand where they are. They've expressed a desire not only to be baptized into faith, but to join the church. And so we want to ask them this question. We accept your profession of faith. We accept your baptism. We're all witness of it. But do the two of you, as a member of the Universal Church, promise to be faithful to Jesus, first and foremost to Jesus, through the ministries of the United Methodist Church, and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries and serve by committing your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, will you say, I will? And we receive you into membership as professions of faith, and we celebrate with you this day.
We've got this thing that tells us what we're supposed to do next, right? We just threw it away. At the end of this, I know there's going to be necks need to be hugged. Find your way to these guys. To be this age and to take this kind of stand for Jesus Christ is amazing. In a world that tells them it's all about you, they're saying, no, it's all about Jesus. And that's an amazing thing. I'm going to ask Andrea to come, and we're going to sing our final song.
Thank you for being with us today. This is, as we say, why we do what we do, just to celebrate, give thanks, rejoice, and praise God. We have not gone to church today. We've been church today. And there's a difference between the two. I pray God be with you, and I ask you to receive this blessing. You go from this place, sisters and brothers, into the mission field, just as surely as if you'd gotten on a bus and gone to Jacksonville. You enter the mission field of a world of people who are hurting, a world of people who are in need, be it for things as simple as water, powerful as the love of Jesus. And you are his missionaries. You are his hands and feet. You are his church. But you do not go alone, and you certainly do not go in your own power. So go in the love of God the Father, who loved you enough to send the Son to rescue you. Go in the grace that Jesus, the Son of God, gives, and the love that was poured out through him on Calvary's cross be poured out in you, on you, and through you. And go in the power of the Holy Spirit to receive grace for when you blow it and fail, but to receive power to lift the Lord on high and be his people, his church, and be his missionaries in this world. Go.